Yes.
I consent.
Okay.
Hey guys. All right. So we're here for the 2019-2020. Who are you guys? ORSAT Thermal Capstone handoff presentation to hand off who they are, what they did, how it worked, and why is my CubeSat a frozen ice cube in space?
Yeah. So we're tasked with performing a thermal analysis of ORSAT. It's the second, I think, the second capstone to do this, but we added the additional difficulty of also testing, not just doing orbital simulations. Unfortunately, 2020, ill-fated year that it was, we weren't able to make and test, but we have a whole lot of we have a whole lot of design documents that we hope to, you know, pass on and share what we have. So I'm going to share my screen if I can.
That's great.
Can y'all see the Google Drive here?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, first I'm just gonna go through where our directory is. So we're located in ORSAT shared and here in thermal, and then the 2019-2020 thermal capstone. I recommend before kind of diving into this video, maybe watching this thermal capstone team 2020 final presentation. It's a really good and also really long overview of everything we did. It's like 40 minutes, but it's our, I mean, it's everything we did just in a nutshell. Somehow even a nutshell took 40 minutes to talk about. So, but I recommend watching that. and then basically, so our project was split into two main divisions, which is the orbital calculations and simulations and the thermal vacuum chamber, or TVAC. So those are split up here at the top. These two folders are kind of the most important directories in here. But there are some other things, some advisor meeting minutes, some capstone class documents, and software resources is probably a folder you might want to look at. This is where we're going to throw, and where we have been throwing, all of our tutorials on the different software we've been using. So there's some thermal desktop software sort of tutorials in there, and some StarCCM stuff's going to go up. So I would check this out if you haven't used those software packages, because they're very important for thermal analysis. Anyway, that said, I'll just sort of very briefly go over kind of what's in here and what you need to actually pay attention to if you're trying to jump on this project.
Hey, Danny, I just wanted to also point out, there's also the report. I think, I don't think you pointed out, but the video and the report. So both of those would be a good.
Maybe read this also. Yeah, this is also really long, but most of it's the appendix. So it's way shorter than you think it is.
But don't stamp on the appendix. If you're going to do anything with the fixture, like that's where all the justification is for design choices are. That's in the appendix.
Right. Yeah. So maybe just read the whole thing. and simulations and calculations, we have basically four main subdirectories. The most important one here being this thermal desktop simulations folder. This is where all of our documents for the actual simulations are. So if you go in here and you download this zip file and decompress, get everything, you know, extract all the folders from there, you'll see a whole bunch of junk. But here, actually, let me open. Can you see this window or no?
No.
No.
Well, never mind. I don't know how to show that. But basically, when you open it, you're going to see all sorts of like text files and just random CSV files. And those are just outputs from Thermal Desktop. The files you really want to pay attention to are the drawing files. So those are the AutoCAD files that you need to open. And Thermal Desktop, if you don't know, it's an AutoCAD plugin built by CNR Technologies. And it's an industry standard for doing thermal simulations in orbit. So anyway, this is a very important zip file. The rest of this stuff goes into some more of the.
Do we have that checked in to a Git repo anywhere?
No, but we will. We should do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I can push it to the thermal Git.
Yeah, please do.
Besides that, some of this other stuff, resources, that's, I think we have some specs in there for helping with some material properties and assumptions we made. Conductance studies, Oleg's going to talk a little bit more about later. That's important for getting more detailed results when you do these orbital simulations. And then UMBC meeting notes. We've been partnering a little bit with Steve Cole at University of Maryland, Baltimore County, who is a thermal desktop wizard. He's been a really good resource. So for anyone wanting to do these thermal simulations, definitely reach out to him with questions. And yeah, he's a really good resource. In the thermal vacuum chamber, we have CAD and PNIDs, we have bills of materials and UT funding sort of thing. We have validation, which includes all of our TVAC sims, and then miscellaneous, which is just kind of everything else. So in here, you can expect to see, I don't know if it's all up yet, but we're still in the process of organizing this. But you'll see links to like our Onshape and all of our models. And then here, you'll see a list of materials and how much they cost, things we bought, things we haven't yet bought, things that maybe still need to be purchased. And then validation is going to be all of our mostly CFD, but some FEA simulations for the TVAC to basically make sure that our design isn't going to blow up. I think that's the gist of our directory. And I think with that, to give you a better idea of what we're actually talking about, I'm going to give it over to Oleg, who's going to talk a bit more about the simulations we did.
Okay. Share my screen. Share. Oops. Okay, can you see that?
Yeah.
Cool. Actually, I'm going to show, this is what Danny was trying to show earlier. So this is that zip file. If you download it, there's a whole bunch of stuff in here, and this is all stuff that Thermal Desktop references. And mostly you're just going to be interested in these document files. So when you've downloaded Thermal Desktop and you open it, you're just going to open this file and it'll automatically pull any of the documents in here that it's trying to reference. Also, when you run like sims or do any sort of plots or anything, it all gets shoved into the same repo, which makes it more messy, but yeah, it's all here. And then, yeah, all the different solutions and everything is in here. But yeah, like, I guess the point is, like Danny said, just these drawing files are pretty much what you're going to be interested in. Okay.
So which is this? I saw up to V6, but this doesn't have a V in the name.
So this is V6, kind of. Ignore the name. this is effectively what it would be. What is V6 in the drive?
Okay.
So yeah, this is the most recent version. Uh huh. Somebody saying something? No. Okay. Yeah, and so V6 is obviously the latest one. It's the one that has the solar panels, the cards, the solar cards, the frames, end caps. And all of the internal, or well, all the internal cards, and it has the two batteries. It has heat loads. So I'm not going to go into like obviously the details of how to use Thermal Desktop, because we actually, in the software resources, there's I think like 6 or so videos on how to actually use it. So I'm just going to kind of gloss over some of the details, but the key points, I guess, are that these are the things that we have physically, and we have connections between all those. Let me actually turn on conductors. So all of these little lines you see, I have the nodes turned off, because if I have them turned on, it's like a total mess. You can't tell what's going on. So we have all the connections between the cards. Each of these connections represents some physical connection. So these are like the M2 screws going through the frame. These are, this right here is like a surface connection that shows so if this is like the interface between the solar cards and the solar panels, which are now going to change because this geometry, these dimensions were based on the previous solar cards or solar panels that we had, which I'm...
Cells, yeah.
Yeah, they're solar cells. They're now different. And I think they're bigger. So so that needs to get changed because that will affect some of the thermals. So yeah, all the connections in place between the cards and the frames. And,
Oleg, real quick, just to clarify, these connections are, they're heat paths. So those are the things that tell Thermal Desktop that heat is going to travel through that. Yeah.
Yeah. So, they're in units of watts per, so it's like a total conductance now. So like the inverse of resistance is what they all are. What else was I going to say? So determining all these values was like a major part because knowing what they are is critical for a lot of them, and some of them are more critical than others. Actually, maybe I should start with there's optical properties, which are like the emissivity and absorptivity for various components. And these values are super important particularly for the exterior components. So like the frames, the solar panels, and the cards. So those are really important and also difficult to determine. Internally, they're less so important. There's less radiation because there's less temperature gradients. Obviously, radiation's driven by that. But still, I mean, we still have them for everything internally as well. There's thermophysical properties, which is like conductivity, density, and a lot of these values are all in the drive. There's so Danny kind of mentioned, so like the connections would be in this conductance study section. This is aluminum to PCB. This is actually this was part of our 411, ME411 project. And this gave us the values between the clamp, the wedge mechanism that's clamping the cards. Mm-hmm. But that value does need to kind of be refined. We hoped to actually run actual testing, maybe in the thermal vacuum chamber, but we didn't get to that. So currently we have just these kind of more rough values that are just scaled geometrically. Battery mount to card, this was done in StarCCM. There's about me or readme files in a lot of these that you can read if you want to know kind of how the values were determined and what the final values were that were used. And then there's also these two. So yeah, there's some references here that we used for. For like some of the values. So this is for wind form. There should be another paper in here that I need to add that gives the thermal conductivity of the batteries themselves and how that was determined. So I need to add that, but that could actually, I'm not sure where it is.
I'll make a note of it.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, because I'll probably forget. it's somewhere in this drive. I'm not sure where it is, but it's I think it's actually the title of it is in that about me or the freaking read me document. So yeah, here's another, so mechanical electrical connections. So there's actually a bunch of values that are in this folder. One of them is some simulations that Ian ran. There's also README on those simulations here and kind of the values that were determined from that. So that's a good thing. And then this conductance connections and total conductance document here is actually for a bunch of different things on the satellite. So like this is this interface between the solar panels and the solar cards and the solar cells. There's like RTV in between here and the way that we determine this connection right here. I think I've highlighted this connection, this surface connection here is in this document. So it's just, you know, a function of the area and the thermal conductivity. And we have links to various, like the connectors, like for these connectors, the solar panel connectors, the 40-pin connector, and then also like where I got material properties for some of these different things could be found in this document. And these were fed back into the main thermal model. Let's see. So yeah, let me go back to this.
Can you go over the orbital cases?
Yes. Yeah, I think that's it for like, Danny, anything else?
No.
Oh, okay, so maybe before orbital cases, I wanted to quickly talk about the like the active versus pass, or I guess that's kind of goes hand in hand. Okay, so yeah. So if we go to our different cases, there's the cold case and the hot case. And then we ran an active and a passive case where there are no internal components on, and we have all the solution, all the all the simulation results are in here for active versus passive, cold and hot. But cold case, the all the cases were run for about 12 hours. I think we were running it for a bit longer before, but we settled on 12 because that was enough to reach steady state. So
and that was because that was some number of orbits and you didn't see it. It was asymptotically close and you said, screw it, it's about that.
Yeah. I think like earlier when we were running, I don't know if we had a high, you know, thermal mass or something, or if we had something funny, but it was taking, like, I remember we would run it for like days or something and we weren't getting, and it was still kind of, you know, yeah. Like you're describing asymptotically reaching, but now it's pretty like pretty solid. Like it drops pretty quick and then, you know, it's there. So
we reach steady state after a couple of orbits, and steady state in orbit doesn't mean you might think it is. It's not just like a straight line where everything's at solid temperature. It's still oscillates because you're going around, but it's a steady state oscillation sort of thing.
Sure.
Yeah, exactly. I'll just show. So yeah, it's like this. So it's steady, but it's not really steady. You know, but it's not declining anymore. So that's kind of what we mean by steady state. So like this, it kind of hits a plateau.
Yeah, no, that's perfect.
Yeah, and so these are actually the different cases. I guess the details of how to actually use this again will be in a video. I'll talk a little bit about the orbits. So we took obviously so what distinguishes the hot case versus the cold case is the orbit. And so you can edit that in Thermal Desktop, and the beta angle is what determines that. So a beta angle about above 70 degrees is going to mean you're in constant sunlight. So this is like the hot case. And then there's a passive and active case of each of those, which is, so the active 75 degree beta angle is like the hottest hot case, right? And then the, oh wait, did I say passive? I mean, active 75 degrees versus 0 degrees, 0 degree beta angle, which is, I always forget which one it is. Okay. Hot case display. So yeah, this is the hot case. And then
where's the sun?
The sun is like, if we're looking at it like this, the sun is to the left. So this blue grid is like the shadow, Earth's shadow. So that way you could kind of see when your satellite, you know, goes into the shadow. Obviously it's not to scale, but the orbit goes above for like a short, for actually for the entire time.
Can you rotate that? Yeah, that way. Yeah. I see.
So see, but yeah, so it's going to be on this line, but obviously it's super small. So it's going to be in constant sunlight. And then once this beta angle starts to shift, it's going to like move, you know, clockwise until it's flat. And then you will see, oh my gosh, zero.
You have to set that as the current orbit and then press display. It's very confusing. So go to the zero beta. Yep, you were still selected on the wrong one.
Oh,
zero beta set current display. Okay. Yeah, there you go.
There. So then this is the cold case where it's going to be, you know, if we look at it from the top view, it's going to enter the shadow here. And obviously this is why it's less than 50%, because, you know, it's just from this point right here where it's sitting now till this point. It's not here that it goes into the shadow. So anyways, this is the cold case.
So we've got hot case and cold case, and describe the difference between active and passive.
And then, so the active and passive is where internally we, there are components that dissipate certain amount of power. And if we go meters, I haven't turned on. Oh, okay, yeah. So in thermal desktop, so we have it defined as heat loads. These are like the different cards and some of the small components that, you know, turn on at different times and dissipate heat. So obviously it's important to know the behavior of those things. So currently we have them all disabled in thermal desktop, meaning this is the passive case. So, you know, if we ran this at 0 degrees, this would be like the coldest of the cold cases. So we can enable them by entering one. Actually, I should just enable all of them. And we have them defined. So apply. Oh, wait, why can't I see them? Danny, do you? I thought I have it displaying.
I know there's a button to toggle them on and off. In a different control.
Oh yeah, that's right.
But they do show up as little red arrows when you can see them.
Yeah. So. Yeah, they should be.
Try to just select one and click the little light bulb thing. Yeah.
Oh no, that's not what I wanted to do. Undo. There we go. Okay.
There it is.
Oops. So yeah, you could see the different locations. Why is this? Okay. Oh, do I have a card turned off? Sorry. So this load, this like distributed load is, should be on a card. It's going to take me a second to find it, so I'm not going to bother, but it's just another one of these cards. So the way that kind of how this little red arrow right here is loading this card, this like array of, oh my gosh. Yeah, Thermal Desktop is funny, by the way. AutoCAD 3D is funny in general. Yeah, this like array of arrows is a distributed heat load. So this is, there's like,
that's fine. I'm a missing card. We get it. Yep.
Yeah, it's distributed across this card. So it's like there on this card, there's a bunch of little components and we just added them up and distributed that. Honestly, this load is so small that it doesn't really affect the model that much. What's more important is some of these bigger loads, like up here, the DX Wi-Fi, and the way that those are modeled is they're time dependent. So we have this array of when it's on and when it turns on and when it turns off. And you could see that this, I don't know if you could, it's probably kind of hard to see, but it's like, you know, it's pulsing, it's turning on here, staying on for like 10 minutes and then shutting off. And so this is happening every orbit and it's happening on the like daytime. Cause you know, so this is for like the DX Wi-Fi. I mean, I don't understand the whole electrical side, but basically, you know, it's gonna be turning on during the day when we're trying to connect to it. So we wanna make sure to line up those with when it's on the day side, not when it's on the night side. Cause that kind of isn't really representing like the hottest case.
Yeah, and to clarify, all of these heat loads are only turned on for active case. So active case is like internals powered on, passive cases, everything's turned off, it's just floating in space.
Cool. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, so the...
So can you start a simulation to see what that looks like?
This one will run, you want, I mean, I have some...
Yeah, show some of the results. On it.
Yeah. What's more interesting, hot, active.
Show cold, passive, and hot, active.
All right, maybe we'll start with cold, passive then. Set to current, close, and
yeah, that button cycles through.
Yeah, I don't know if it's gonna, if it's a bit much for it to do it on the spot. Okay.
You don't have to, that's fine. Don't push it. Okay. Don't push it.
I think it should load up. I think it's gonna
load. Okay, cool. There it goes. Oh, that's great. So, yeah, you could see, oh gosh. So the cold case, yeah, it's a little bit hard to tell, but yeah, it's obviously, it's going to continue to change throughout the whole thing because, you know, it dips back behind the earth and then it, you know, comes back to the front. So it's, but yeah, you can see the temperature changes start on the outside, then they bleed in into the inside and then, you know, down to the batteries and whatever other components we are interested in. So maybe I'll also show.
That's fun.
So the, what I just showed is this guy. So the cold cases, that is zero beta angle, have much higher oscillations. So that we just saw this case here.
Can you actually zoom in using the plus button down below?
Yeah, oops.
Okay, thanks.
Oops, oh gosh. Yeah, so we just have three different things displayed here. Backplane, solar panels, which you're obviously going to see the highest fluctuations because they're on the outside, and the most sudden, you know, like that's why you could see these like sudden drops because it's not seeing any sunlight and then all of a sudden it's seeing sunlight. And then the batteries are the most subtle because they're like inside the satellite. So they're kind of, you know, isolated, and there's some thermal impedance by the time the heat flows in and out of them. So, so that's good. I mean, at least, you know, it's all making sense logically. Okay, so this is done. You could actually export these animations. It kind of consumes a lot to do that, but let me switch to hot active, which set to current. Yeah, it's hard to remember which of these buttons do what, but everything is like in here too.
Yeah, and that that folder with all that junk in it, it's some of those folders are the results that it's reading from right now. So it's important
to just
delete those, yeah.
Yeah, I think, oops, oh no. Let me try that again. I want to see the cards there. Because you'll see the, oh wait, is this, oh no, this is active. Yeah. So you see that the heat load just kind of pops on there for a moment. That's like, just that like 10 minutes, we turn it on to, you know, communicate.
Yeah, that's great.
Good. So, oops, I keep. Okay. All right. So those are the. Yeah. So that's kind of the main.
So overview. Just for giggles, go show us the hot active case on the graphs.
Oh yes, which is very interesting looking. And so there's some. These spikes. This is the hottest node on the backplane, not on that C3 card that I think is that the C3 card that I was showing that like showed that little burst.
The DX Wi-Fi maybe?
Yeah. The DX Wi-Fi. Oh yeah. Yeah, that one's got the 6 watts, I think. So that card currently has like a point load that is really high, but that's kind of not realistic because it's, you know, in reality it's being applied to some amount of mass. So that's the thing that kind of needs to get adjusted. So that's why I didn't plot the hottest node on the DX Wi-Fi card, because it's like, it shoots up, but I don't know. So one of the things is is it the MOSFET on that that's getting that hot, or what's the?
It's a power amplifier. And one of the things that we'll be doing this summer is making the, thermal connection between that power amplifier and the case, because we have to dump the heat. We can't get above about 80°C. And so we have to dump the heat into the frame.
Okay. Yeah, that's a challenge because it does get hotter than that.
Yep. That's fine. So this is so great. But, so what you're saying is that we've got a frozen CubeSat. It's completely and utterly frozen. I mean, we do get to unfreeze for a little while in the hottest case, but we're not usually in the hottest case, so.
Well, that's another, I think that's another caveat with all of these, is all of these temperatures are very dependent on the optical properties of the external components. So we notice when we change the emissivity and absorptivity of the solar cards, for instance, to match something that Steve Cole did for his, the temperatures drop by, I don't remember, was it 10 or 20 degrees?
I was like, yeah, I was like almost 20.
So, I mean, all of this is very dependent on the optical properties. And if there's a way to test those or get specs, that'd be fantastic. But
yeah. The other thing is, Yeah, I mean, those values were really extreme. And I would like to meet with him. And I mean, I know, you know, if we're, no, okay, we're not.
I think what we'll do is we'll now do the right thing, which is congratulations, team. You've got a working simulation that I don't think is garbage. This is super cool. And this is exactly
all right. We're done here, guys. Let's pack it up.
Yeah, I think that's it.
And for all.
And you've got the hot case and the cold case, which is what we asked you for. So I'm not going to give you guys A's, you know, but maybe you might pass now.
Might.
Wow.
You are allowed to graduate.
No, you guys.
At this point, that's all I care about.
That's right. You guys are too useful to graduate, so we're failing you. Sure. the thing that is really exciting to me is that we're now arguing about the thermal properties of the thing that we build the CubeSat of, which is exactly where we should be now, because we've got the first emissivities from the new cells that we're using. And this summer, I want to actually test the emissivity of the Osh Park boards, mm-hmm. and blah blah blah. And that's exactly where we should be. So that's great.
That brings up one last note for the orbital simulations. I think, unless you have more to add, but I think that future work for this would be adding antennas, which might be parasitic pads. Mm-hmm. Adding some of the cameras, modeling them somehow, and then doing a lot more testing. So as soon as you can go back on the campus, I mean, those conductance studies we did, those need to be done on so many thermal interfaces, and we need to get the vacuum chamber up and running again so that we can test it in a, you know, where there's no medium for convection, so that we're actually getting accurate results. But we need basically resist. Conductance values for almost mm-hmm. every connection that is important to us. And right now we only have, you know, a few.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, some of them are more important than others, so we can triage them a little bit. And some of them have higher effects than others, you know. So, you know, the optical properties of the wind farm is probably much less important than of like the Osh Park ports, because, you know, But yeah, Danny's right. There's a lot, like, it's a lot of refining that needs to be done. Another thing is the whole thermoelectric cooling system for the, you know, none of that is put in here.
Right.
My understanding. So that, you know, that's going to consume a lot of, you know, I know that's being worked on separately, but that needs to be more or less plugged in here, because that could have, you know.
So let me ask two questions. The first is, so you guys think you can measure thermal conductance relatively well in the vacuum chamber once that's back up and running?
Yeah. especially with Steve Cole, kind of help, because he's done a million of these conductance studies. And so I know Oleg and I have specifically told him, as soon as we can kind of get back on campus and get our vacuum chamber running, he's going to probably share his, you know, test techniques. And it's a pretty simple test, actually, but it's very important.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then, have you guys ever done or heard of doing our own emissivity and absorptivity tests?
The problem is that it's fairly easy to get emissivity and absorptivity values within a certain band, but the values we need are total hemispherical absorptivity and emissivity, which accounts for every one of the thermal bands. So the difficult part is getting that value. I mean, it's kind of easy to find what's the absorptivity or emissivity in, say, like the visible range, but you also have to account for, you know, IR and other thermal bands. So that's where it gets tricky, and we might need to maybe outsource that testing. I'm not sure.
Okay, that would be really interesting to see. And that's something that maybe we'll talk about more about this summer. Okay, great. Thank you.
Cool. Okay, I think that's probably a good stopping point for orbital sims, and we'll move on to thermal vacuum chamber.
Awesome.
So I'm going to stop sharing. And Ian, do you want to take over here?
Um, Okay, so we're in the folder number two here, thermal vacuum chamber. This is basically what it is a few little, few subsystems. The biggest one, of course, is actually this vacuum chamber that's in FAB 60-12 right now. Basically, we were going to put a fixture in there that is going to hold liquid nitrogen. And that's basically what it was, is a vacuum insulated liquid nitrogen reservoir. That's what the pieces were. So in here, the subsystems as follows were basically what we're going to call the plumbing. Then there's the fixture, kind of the two critical subsystems. And then within the, for the fixture itself, there are further subdivisions of the subsystems, them being the shroud, the turntable, and basically a turning mechanism and lifting mechanism for the turntable, and then the solar simulator, and now a fifth subsystem, because I think it's justified, for the mounting that has to occur inside the vacuum chamber. So some of the most important models are going to actually be found on Onshape, because that's where the final model is, or that's where the final model will be. And that's also where the updated, so this is the final, or that's at least the shroud.
Hold on. I didn't know this. So you guys started in SolidWorks, right?
Technically, we started in Inventor and Onshape. And then now there's some free Fusion 360 work, but I want everything to be in Onshape because, I mean, that's where I think the majority of things are now, or at least the most up-to-date things are.
Yeah, good. Okay, great. So I'm happy to hear it's in Onshape because that's where I'd like us to go as a team. So that's great.
Yeah, I used Onshape pretty much exclusively for the shroud. So that's all the, yeah. This is like pretty much my work area is this, what he's showing you right now. So it has all the shroud stuff in it.
I need to get my stuff pushed over to Onshape. I've been doing it locally on my Fusion 360 for like the solar sim mounting and stuff, but that will happen now that finals are done.
Okay. So yeah, that's kind of how, I mean, anything that I did really early on, like it was all in Inventor and then everything was getting pushed to Onshape just because it was where everybody could collaborate. So right now this version of, so this is the shroud right here. This is a sub assembly for it. It doesn't have, I'm a little surprised. So we have, Mike, you have all these pictures.
If you want to show them the last version, it's in that archive folder all the way to the right. And that has like most of the stuff.
That guy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's probably like the most complete assembly in there.
It's getting overview.
So this shows what I'm, okay. So right now, this is the solar simulator just floating out there. And this is why, so Zach did work in Fusion 360 and there is another component to this, like this T-frame here, where it's actually mounting the solar simulator. So that's the other subsystem. The turntable's in the center here. This is a placeholder for what the ORSAT frame would be. I didn't want to slap in the entire ORSAT in there. It gets a little big file-wise. And then of course, all along the outside here is the shroud. Some of the other little small subsystems that I mentioned were like the turning and lifting mechanisms. And I don't know if am I just mentioning them or do I go into them right now? Is that what you?
I would like you to go through each subsystem and talk about it and how it's used and what it is and why it is. And just you're doing an overview right now. So.
Okay, cool. So these guys right here, the shroud and the turntable are actually the reservoirs for liquid nitrogen. They have a hollowed out piece. So they have this volume on the inside where they're supposed to contain liquid nitrogen. And then they have on this top end here and in the back is where they vent the vapor that escapes, not into the vacuum chamber, but through the vacuum chamber. We have isolated pass-throughs that have been ordered, and you can find that in the the UTEEP and bomb section. And that's important delineation, is that there's no vapor getting into the vacuum chamber proper. This whole thing sits inside the vacuum chamber, and then everything leaks outside. So it's as if, you get it. So
I mean, some will leak inside it, but there's nothing you can do about it.
Yeah, potentially. So that alludes to some of the testing and validation that we were trying to do, is to determine whether or not there was going to be deformation. That would lead to leaks. That would lead to a de-vacuum. I don't know what the word is for that, but basically an increase in pressure in our vacuum chamber. So the turntable is the same thing. It also has its little internal volume here. But the turntable has what it's supposed to do. And you can see this right here. It has this copper fixture plate that, this isn't to size, but for reference, that basically, as the copper plate sits on this cryogenic reservoir, it conductively cools the ORSAT, or the CUBE satellite, right? And that's just to get it down faster to temperature, because in this vacuum chamber, if all you have is the radiative mode of cooling, you could be sitting there for a while before you finally reach, a cold enough steady state. So that's why it's there. That also basically said why the shroud's there. The shroud is there for the radiative cooling mode. These get really cold. Boiling temperature of liquid nitrogen at standard temperature and pressure is 77 to 78 Kelvin. It's like negative 190 C. That's what temperature it should ultimately get down to. The idea was to keep feeding this fixture, probably just the shroud. The turntable only had a limited run time because you only needed it for the very initial points of testing. You keep feeding it, the shroud, with liquid nitrogen, and you would keep it down as low as possible, which should approach that 77 degrees Kelvin. So that's how that goes. How does the turntable lift, and how does it rotate? Because that's another thing. The CubeSat's got to rotate, right? So let's go back to home. So there's this motor mount. I'm sorry, I don't mean to flip back and forth too much here, but so on the side of this here, this needs a little bit of a redesign, but this is where our two NEMA 17 vacuum-rated stepper motors are going to be. And these are what are going to turn and lift this copper fixture plate here. So this first one here, the one that's kind of at an angle, there's going to be like a flex shaft. It's just something that you would usually find in your car that just transmits angular force, and that feeds through the center of the turntable here and fits into this coupler that's on the copper fixture plate, and it's not attached to anything but the copper fixture plate. The second stepper motor, and it has this conflict here because it needs a change based on updated geometry. The second stepper motor drives a chain, which is wrapped around this, it's CRP, or the windform plastic. The chain will be wrapped around this, and this is a three-piece lead screw design. So this nut, this sprocketed nut or whatever, that has the chain on it, it's actually two pieces that fit into each other like a donut. And on the side here, you can see where this would be where you'd put your the helical insert or whatever, and you put a set screw in there to keep them together. This turns, and now is about the time when you can see in the center there that this is where the screw portion of the lead screw is. That's what's going to turn, and because now it's time to get out of here. So straight on here. So there's that nut. These two pieces, this sprocketed nut here is actually constrained in place by this base plate, right? It's just across the bottom of the turntable and it splits them and houses our borosilicate ball bearings. So because that's constrained in place and it must rotate, that makes the lead screw go up and down. That's this piece right here.
Hey, Ian, why are we using borosilicate ball bearings?
Couple of reasons. It's one is because they're good for minimizing vibrations. And borosilicate is very similar to Pyrex, so it's extremely thermally resistant. So it can get really cold, it can get really hot, and it'll just deal with it. We won't have to worry about our bearings falling apart.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. So, yeah, and so now that we've mentioned the bearings, another kind of part of this is that it has two bearing races, two isolated bearing races, one for to enable the rotation of this sprocketed lead screw design, and the other to basically allow for the fixture plate to rotate independently of the lead screw. So that's how this works. Or that's how that rotation aspect of it works.
So let me just ask a quick question. Right now we're in fully extended mode, so we're a few millimeters above the cold plate.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So we're now in sort of like we've been cooled down and now we're going to start spinning like we're in space.
Yes. It doesn't need to clear very high.
Right. Okay, good. And so if I turn the sprocket, then the thing sinks down and then the copper plate jams into the aluminum reservoir.
Mm-hmm. I wouldn't say yes, it meets contact. It's more of a subtle rest rather than a jam. If I'm being honest.
Gentleman's rest, if you will.
Yeah, but since there's no air in between, you won't have a whole lot of resistance there.
Yeah, it's just, it's a subtle rest.
Ideally, this would have been something we would have built and tested and perfected. And the going is that it needs to be built and tested and then maybe perfected.
Good, excellent.
Yes, okay.
Does anybody else besides me have questions, by the way? Emilio, Emmy, Tony, you guys should be yelling questions if you got them.
I'm just absorbing information at this point. So.
Okay.
So there's one thing with the cryo system that we want to keep in mind because it really will drastically change testing times. I don't want to jump on your toes, Ian, if you're going to talk about the Leidenfrost effect and that change in time it takes to cool down. So what happens when liquid nitrogen meets a room temperature surface is that it immediately starts to boil, and that will form a little vapor layer. And that vapor layer can be rather insulative. So it'll insulate and it'll take a lot longer to get past the film boiling point and into the nucleate boiling point where you really get that good phase change. And we did some calculations on that to understand a bit more about how that boiling was going to take place. And we found that the test should take anywhere between 10 minutes and 9 hours to get cold. Now it's going to be closer on the 10 minute side than it is on the 9 hour side, just because of turbulence and the way that boiling is going to occur. And I think that we estimated you'll need somewhere between 13 and 20 liters of liquid nitrogen. 13 being a modest, but if you get 20, you'll be A-okay to do a test. But that is something else that will need to be tested because we're not exactly sure how that transition between film boiling to nucleate boiling is gonna behave and how that's gonna affect testing times. So that'll be something that you'll just monitor with the thermocouples and watch those liquid lines and just keep it full and keep it cold until you start to reach your steady state.
Fantastic foreshadowing. because we're gonna get there.
Okay, sorry.
I'm hoping that pretty much covered the fixture on the inside. I want to talk a bit more about the plumbing. The plumbing shouldn't take that long. Inside of this archive, this is Thermal Capstone, file number 2, design, CAD and PNID, or PNIDs. And keep in mind, most of the very important CAD is going to be on Onshape. So keep that in mind. So we're gonna go to cryogenics and plumbing. The final design that we ultimately ended up coming up with right here, final cryo pour in PNID PDF. It amounts to, there's more to it than this, but in a nutshell, it is we're pouring liquid nitrogen into the fixture. So, and that's what this looks like. So we have a Dewar inside of FAB 60-12. I suspect it's along the lines of a 50 liter Dewar. It's rather sizable. It doesn't have the size on the side of it. But when you compare dimensions to other commercially bought Dewars, that's what it kind of falls in line for. So the point of contact that we use for like our chemistry stuff, his name is Nicholas Myers, Meyer. You find his name on the gas expansion calculator that was just before this. The idea here, basically we take liquid nitrogen out of the Dewar. We have a funnel at the very top where our pass-throughs are going to be. And then we would have a valve, a multiple way valve that can basically, we can turn either off or into the shroud or into the turntable. That's how it was going to go. So basically you control what gets filled and when. And it's important to note that that's important because you don't actually, for the majority of your test, you don't need to have the turntable filled. So it's a liquid nitrogen savings kind of thing. Over on here, we have a phase separator. And what a liquid nitrogen phase separator is it's a means of, it's a lot of times you see them as like this, they look porous and coarse, almost
like a gold cork.
Yeah, or I was gonna say a pumice stone made out of brass. It kind of looks like. And that's so, with all that porosity, there's a high amount of surface area, and basically like when liquid hits it, it's either it hits it and then like there's a lot of vaporization that occurs. And a lot of time in this particular line, it allows for us to like basically keep all the liquid in the fixture, and the only thing that's coming out is vapor. So, So, and then the other side of this is that the room that the vacuum chamber is currently in, we did not intend for that vacuum chamber and the TVAC in general to stay in that room. We were going to take it up to the fourth floor. The room number escapes me, but it's the one with the 3 like welding hoods, vents or whatever. Does anybody
480 know? Lab 40.
Yeah,
that's 480.
That one. Yeah. So that was going to have a whole lot of ventilation. So this is the final design that we did for a PNID. I think it's important to note that there is a second very viable PNID, but it will kind of affects like what we're using liquid, and the first one that we were given that we had was using vapor, but it doesn't mean it's any less viable. It just means that there's trade-offs, and that's still found in this here, or in the same directory.
So I'm gonna ask a question about the PNID. What is that funny thing? Manual cryo pump. Is that a fancy word for us pouring this out?
No.
So I found these online, and it's a siphon. It's a tube siphon that fits onto the Dewar, like what we have, and you can buy them online. We hadn't because they ship from China primarily, and there have been a lot of delays understandably so. But it's just a little manual pump that you squeeze the ball on the top of it, and it will draw the liquid nitrogen up and then feed it out through a tube. You could do a pouring method, but we spec'd that out and have that on hold to buy because it'll be a lot safer than pouring liquid nitrogen into the vacuum chamber.
Undergraduates are going to do it, so it's fine if they spill it on themselves. All right, so we pump it into the little cuppy thing, the funnel, and then that goes into the two-way ball valve, and what I'm trying to understand is the two-way ball valve, it either points to the vent or it points in? Is that what happens?
Either points to the shroud or the turntable, or it's off. And that ball valve is really just to keep it from boiling and spitting back up and out to make sure that it's escaping out through the other end of the vacuum chamber.
Okay, this is what I was confused about. Okay, so there's actually two cryo lines from the funnel, and we get to choose whether it goes to the plate or to the thingy, the shroud. Okay, gotcha. Correct. And then both of those vent to the same vent on the outside.
Right.
Okay. Yes. We would have to connect them. These pass-throughs do actually have their two tubes, so we would connect them at the end of the day. But I think the long story short is that this shroud and this turntable, when it's in here and all connected up, if this valve is completely closed, it's actually still open to atmosphere. Like there's nothing that's shut off this end here. So any vapor that is residual there, it escapes out that way, or it's pushed out that way.
Okay, and then just out of curiosity, is there any reason we wouldn't just want to flood the whole thing with liquid nitrogen and leave it that way?
You're wasting liquid nitrogen.
Okay, because you're cooling down the table for no reason, I guess, is your point.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. So the table itself, is the one that we kind of want to be able to turn off, because there's no once the plate's off, it's not doing anything.
Okay. Plus, you're going to be keeping on adding liquid nitrogen to and monitoring those thermocouples to make sure that it's still full. So it'll just be easier if you only have to monitor the shroud for the duration of the test and add liquid nitrogen just to maintain that temperature.
Great.
This meeting also for pitching future work for this?
Yeah.
Okay. So there's one other reason why I could foresee why you would still fill the turntable, and that's because the turntable could double as a potential heat sink for the solar simulator. Mm-hmm. Could. If that's something that you want to do.
That's not going to be there when it's out in orbit, though.
What?
I see what you're saying. Okay.
Like, David Lay had once told me that the solar simulator was going to need cooling.
Cooling, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But just telling me it needs cooling doesn't tell me how much.
Right.
And there's a lot of cooling in there. Like, a lot. It's really more how do you direct it, I think. So that's really the challenge with that future work.
Mm-hmm. And that's another opportunity for those motor mounts, depending. I don't think that the motors are going to overheat in the vacuum chamber, but there's no convection in there. So they're vacuum rated, they're cryo rated. But if you do need any additional heat sinks, you can sink it to that T-bar extrude as well.
Mm-hmm. So that's our PNID. I briefly showed Mike McKenzie's PNID. It is vapor driven. Basically, it's boiled off vapor from a commercial dewar. This is a bit of a recirculation line here so that you actually have like some insulating vapor for the dewar itself. But that's how this in a nutshell works, is it uses boil off vapor that would go into a fixture. And in my opinion, since our fixture is designed for liquid nitrogen, you'd probably have to make some modifications to implement this in a more effective means. But you could probably implement this with some other changes. So I'll just leave it at that. Yes. Any questions about that? Okay. This gas expansion calculator, this is coming from the chemistry department. It's basically, it's for your room dimensions. It's like, you're not allowed to have this much liquid nitrogen if you have a very small room and no ventilation. That's what this workbook is for. It's just a calculation. You put in your room dimensions, and then it uses the expansion rate of liquid nitrogen and be like, you can't put any more liquid nitrogen in this room. So
liquid nitrogen is really good at displacing oxygen, and you kind of need oxygen to, you know, breathe.
You will die. The most important safety piece of this, to this point, because obviously we haven't built it, we, you know, have a lot more work to go there. But we spoke with the chemistry department, and for the volume of liquid nitrogen we'll have, if all of it blows up and spills, you're to close the door for 10 minutes and then everything will be fine. So with that calculator, that's what.
But leave the room before you close the door.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Before you leave, like leave and close the door, make sure anything living is outside of the door when it gets closed. Wait 10 minutes and you'll be fine.
That's good. So we'll need a safety SOP then for when we're running this and when we deal with liquid nitrogen and stuff like that. That's great. Okay, good.
Yep.
Yes. And there is a chemicals safety handling class that you'll have to go through that the chemistry department offers, I think, every term or bi-yearly. I'm not sure. But okay. Yeah.
Last thing in this big folder is one subfolder that's called Archive with Today's Date. Inside this archive, it's basically what I thought, it's old stuff. It's basically previous iterations. And one notable example, like why I don't necessarily, like I wanted the, like this needs to be here, but if you go into this archive, try and have an idea of like why you're in here, because just to show you, like these are like some of the things that like, there's going to be one particular PNID, like this one. We're not even going with it yet. We're not even going with it anymore, right? There were a bunch of PNIDs that we did that had basically, we pitched a control system, and it just was not feasible. And like anytime you see like a prior design or a prior iteration or revision in one of these archives, I guarantee you that in our final report, in the appendix or in the body for the TVAC stuff, there's justification for why we did not go with this. In particular, why we didn't go with this one is because it's a lot more complex than the old one. And it's just, it was not, this one actually was a couple iterations down the road. So there's no control system, but it's still using the Venturi nozzle, which we still have.
Yeah. So I'm going to stop you there. Yeah. In general, we really don't like archives. And I was going to say this till later, but I'll say it now. And the reason why is in 2015 or whatever year it is now, everything is Google search. And so when we search for something, we're going to find all the archived results. And so we won't know which is the right one. And so in general, even though it's painful, I'm going to recommend that someone go through and remove the archives and only leave the final products.
Fantastic. I'm actually relieved to hear that, because that's what my position is, like all this is just going to be confusing.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, good. Well, that's all right. Any of the stuff that I organized, like whole hog, pitch it. Okay. Mm-hmm.
It's painful because you go through all these, you know, iterations of cycles, and you want to somehow capture that for future reference. The mm-hmm. problem is that it's really confusing to capture that cycle, and I don't know of a good way of doing it besides writing about it. Like, these are some of the things we thought about, but that don't do them, right?
Yeah.
But having the documents separately on the drive just doesn't work.
I would say that our final report in the appendix did at least try to document right. those changes.
Good.
All right, so let's back out of this. That's basically the end of like the TVAC fixture. And now I want to step into the validation stuff, basically going to trying to model the boiling characteristics here. And you know what? I'm probably like, so you have to have star to open up the boiling sim. You have to have ANSYS to do, Mike, did you end up putting in your shrouds? No.
Okay. They're not in there. I just noticed that. So I'll put those in there today.
Okay. So a rundown of like what these, the shroud and the turntable simulations, like we mentioned it before. Probably the most likely mode of failure that's going to happen for this fixture is that there's going to be a leak with the nitrogen vapor, which basically, removes vacuum level. Okay. And we needed to determine whether or not the seals that hold all these pieces of metal together are going to deform such that they're going to have leaks as they contract. And as they're basically, because it's vacuum, and then as they expand, because, you know, boiling causes a pressure. That's what these simulations are trying to achieve.
And just to add on to that, in case any of us aren't there doing the testing, when using cryo systems, you will have leaks. Like, that's just the matter, it's a part of the beast. But just trying to mitigate those and make them as minimal as possible is kind of what you want to set out to do. But yeah, with cryo systems, there's going to be leaks. So don't lose your head or go chasing your tail over it.
Yep. So, thermal sense. So inside here, this is for the turntable, that system that you saw. Don't have, oh, they're actually right out in front. So this .wbpj file is what you would be opening up for ANSYS to get my thermal sim. Basically, it's the mechanical contraction of it cooling down. I don't have ANSYS on this computer. So that's just what it is. You got to have this STP to have that, or to see that.
Can you also guys go through and remove copy of, which is also confusing?
Yeah. I'll do that after the fact.
Yeah, so, yeah, after this.
Okay, so yeah. This guy right here, this one's probably the bread and butter. This is what the turntable cryo volume fraction rev for conjugate heat transfer problem. That's the big thing. It's the interaction between the fluid volume that we are going to have in there and the solid mass. And that's what, and it looks like this, a blank screen. Okay, so this is basically the turntable box. This is the mesh that we did. On the inside here, there's two different meshes. There's a solid body mesh, that'd be this purple now. And then there's the internal. That's where all the fluid is housed. The goal of this simulation was to basically, you have the internal volume that's going to have a saturated liquid vapor mix that's going to be changing. This is a transient model. It's over the duration of the first 3 seconds that it fills up. And basically, this is a snapshot at 3 seconds of the solution. So basically how this thing cools down over the course of those 3 seconds and what fluid parameters are actually happening. So a couple of like the scenes over here, they're just the solution. So what we basically use this for is, you know, you're going to have higher pressures when you have a lot more recirculation zones. So we wanted to identify, like, where are we going to have recirculation zones? Well, you have a lot over here on the outlet. You naturally have recirculation with boiling to begin with. And then you have some reverse flow. So this kind of, what it's not really the solution necessarily, I think, for this that's important. It's actually the setup. We did a video, right? You, Tara, me, and Mike, right? So we got to retrieve that video of basically how I set this up. I actually think Danny was a part of that too, weren't you?
Yeah, I think so.
So, but yeah, this right here, the, you know, you can look at this all day, but what you really want to look at here, take a look at the boundary conditions, basically how we set up, you know, the physics. When I say boundary conditions, I mean like the inlet here. This is the inlet. This is a plug. And then this is actually the vapor outlet. So it's like, what did I set those for? So the incoming saturated liquid mix that's coming in is set at 25% liquid nitrogen and 75% vaporous nitrogen. So that would be, if you really wanted to get very rigorous with this, you could end up doing like a whole sweep of every single ratio of the mixture. You can do a whole sweep of a lot of the different parameters. But after that, continua is where you set up your models, which are another one that's really important. So take a look at like basically all of this. This, when you're setting up your simulation, is what you want to pay attention to, because these are the mathematical models that are actually solving your stuff. So pay attention to that. The solid models, not as important. Just make sure that they're kind of congruent. Like don't click. Both models got to be implicit unsteady. I think I use segregated energy model. But yeah, anyway, we'll find that video and we'll look it up. Barring anything else, look at the continua and look at the region, the boundary parameters. And then there's a couple of fancy things that I did. These reports are nice, like how some of these reports are set up are good for like getting particular data. But in all fairness, like these scenes that you see, they're nice for visualizing, but I mean, the meat and potatoes of this whole thing is the regions, the models, all that stuff. So pay attention to this. Any questions about this guy? Okay.
That's really cool.
Yeah, it was a bit of a, it was an endeavor. It's a journey.
Well, I'm pleased that you guys did that in particular, because I feel like it took the next step for the to show that this was not stupid. So it's good.
Do we have pictures of the ANSYS models or the ANSYS simulations in the report, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, I just want to go over those slightly, just to get like eyes on.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. And then we should wrap up. It's been an hour and a half.
Oh, well.
Sounds good. Yep. So this is what you ended up coming out with, like your ANSYS models. And this is just, as it cools down, you know, where do you see, like due to contraction of these, like where are your stresses? So something that I kind of, you can do a lot of this for the entire fixture. That's all I'll say about that. But that's something you should look at, especially when you have like any sort of points that are fixed to one another, just to see, because like a lot of times we have steel, brass, and aluminum as our like primary materials. And steel will rip right out of aluminum. So something to, food for thought.
I do want to talk about that deformation model. So getting that ANSYS license was kind of last minute, and like we had it for a while and then it expired on the first and we had to get a new one. So this deformation just, it takes into account frictionless support. So this isn't mounted in any way. It's basically just laying kind of on the ground, but you do kind of get like an overall view of the deformation. But if it's mounted in the central mounting, like we kind of came up with, it's going to deform towards that center point and not really as you see it here.
Okay. So that's all I really have, unless there's questions.
You have a question. How dare you? I'm going to just throw into, I'll add it to the repository. I have not had time to do anything besides trying to finish my finals and exams with kids at home. But I do have some microcontroller coding put together for the stepper motors, as well as I have some Abacus stress models, which they didn't match up entirely with the but they show that the stresses are happening in the same areas. We never could totally figure out why they didn't match up exactly, but Abacus is something that people in the future will have access to via the labs, and Hormoz is a whiz at that. And then, that was the one thing that jumped out at me that I forgot that I need to upload.
Andrew, do you have any more questions for us?
I'm not getting any audio from him.
He's in his own world.
Did he say it's perfect? It looked like he mouthed it.
Well, I think that's what he said. Oh, cool. Perfect? Yeah, he loves it. I think that's what he said.
Yeah.
He said, I cannot find one problem with this.
I'm actually just going through I just went through the final report, just breezed through it. And then you're all fired for not letting us view the video before today. Because this looks great.
Hey, so, I put that in the PSAS meeting notes.
Boom.
And mentioned it.
Great. And we totally got that. Yeah, great.
Okay, good. Well, you got 45 minutes to kill. You got the link. So
all good. So this is great. You guys, good job. Really, really good job. I'm really pleased. I really feel like despite the virus, this was a successful project. And had that virus not been around, I feel like we could have gotten, we would have really nailed this. So congratulations, you guys. Really proud of it and really happy you did this. I think that you have set us on the path for success on ORSAT, which I really appreciate, because this was the big existential crisis that we were facing, which is what's going to happen to the damn satellite in space. So
turns out a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, probably lots that.
How do you want to hand off the Onshape stuff?
You need to transfer it to me, on my ADG4 at pdx.edu account. And that, is part of the shared ORSAT directory. And we'll put it all in there and then people can get access to it from there.
Okay, cool.
We have a request to be part of the ORSAT group, or send me a request to do that. And then, I'll add you to the group, and then I think you can just transfer it.
Okay, cool.
I think I'm part of the group, and I think I can just do that.
Cool. Awesome. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so I've got a list. I'll send out an email of the, short list of things that we want to make sure are in the drive and archive, and we can follow up on that on Sunday. Wait, no, we graduate Sunday, so we won't be...
Goodbye. All right, I'm going to officially stop the recording, and then I want to talk to you guys afterwards.
Cool. Here it comes.